The good thing with charcoal is that it does not produce smoke. It does not smoke completely. It's very clean, unlike firewood. So firewood is dirty, and you have to wait for it to dry up, which takes some time. Unlike charcoal, like you can burn a tree which is wet, and it's going to like after it burns, after it becomes charcoal, it's clean. So that's the good thing with charcoal.
My name's Max Gagliardi, and this is Always Be Building. If you're watching this video, take a moment, hit the subscribe button on YouTube, or you can follow me on your favorite podcast app. Hope you enjoy the show. Jusper, welcome to the podcast. Thanks for coming on.
Thank you very much, Max.
I came across you on Twitter. I love the content that you put out. It's where I find a lot of the guests for the podcast. You're always putting out great videos. And I think everybody should go and check you out. I'll put your Twitter bio in the notes for the episode, but why don't you just tell everybody who you are and give some background, and then we'll launch into it.
Okay. My name is Jusper Machogu. I am from Kenya. I'm young, and then I'm an agricultural engineer. I'm also into energy mostly. I'm a farmer. I'm many things. I advocate for fossil fuels use in Africa mostly.
I think the best way to start would be to talk about the energy side and what you in your life and in your culture, how you have to get energy, what you guys do to create your own energy or to get energy. So I think it's really fascinating.
Okay. So how we get our energy mostly, we get energy from burning firewood, others getting from burning charcoal. I have done a presentation, like a video on burning charcoal, because about a month ago, about 3 weeks ago, we were burning charcoal, and it's a long process. But that's how basically we get firewood, we get our energy. So mostly firewood. Actually, about 90% of energy consumption in sub-Saharan Africa comes from burning firewood, biomass. So that's how we mostly get our firewood. Some people say electricity, but if you come to a place like Kenya, we have access to electricity, but access is not the problem. The problem is we are poor people. Poor people don't have refrigerators. They don't have microwaves. They don't have dishwashers. They don't have laundry machines. So we are using so little electricity. Like in our home, we use about 15 kilowatt hours a month. So that's so little compared to, let's say, your refrigerator. So the problem is, like, we have to be rich and fed before we can afford the other luxuries.
How expensive is it? Is it easy to get the electricity, or is it expensive once you get it, or how accessible it is to get electricity there?
Getting electricity is fairly accessible. Like, the government is working on a program to ensure that most of the Kenyans have access to electricity. So it's not such a big problem. But if you decided to get electricity by yourself, it's going to be very hectic, costly, because, you know, we are a developing country, and you have to bribe your way into various, like, it's hectic. But if you wait for the government, it's very cheap.
Yeah, interesting. But, like, the point that you made is that, like, even to need electricity, you have to have electronics, right? You have to have a refrigerator, you have to have heating and air conditioning. These things are all expensive, a microwave, et cetera. And so if you don't have those things, then you're really more focused on heating, cooking, things like that, right? I mean, it's more like the basics and the necessities versus the luxury items. Is that right?
How we use our energy mostly is like, okay, it could be transport, it could be heating, but mostly cooking. So, and of course, in our farms, like working, maybe weeding, stuff like that. But so how we get, like, getting having access to electricity is not a solution to our energy problem, because we, even in the US, most people don't cook using electricity. They use cooking gas. They cook using gas. So I'd say if we had access to, let's say, fossil fuels, we had access to LPG, we had access to LNG, that would really be amazing for us, because, like, once we substitute firewood for cleaner, more efficient, affordable, and easily accessible energy, it's going to be good for us.
Yeah, no, definitely. I think that's an important thing for the listeners to understand. Why don't you talk through the what you guys do when it comes to the charcoal side? Because you made that video and it was extremely interesting to me because I've read about it before, but just seemed like the amount of work and time and effort into getting charcoal, it's way more than I would have expected. And I'd love for you to walk the listeners through that process and everything that it takes to get to where you make your own charcoal.
So first we have to cut a tree down or trees down. And we have like specific trees to cut down. I don't know their names. Like I know their names in our native language, not the English language.
What are the names in your native language? Just curious.
Okay, I'm directly translating it. So we have the English tree. It's a hardwood. We have avocado trees. We can use those ones. Other people use eucalyptus, but we don't do that because like it burns so it burns easily, quickly, and we don't want that. So we have to cut a tree down. Most people use axes. That's manual. Other people use power saws. They are cheaply, they are readily available, and it's affordable. But most people cannot access that, so they use axes. Then after cutting the tree down, you have to like arrange it and then cover it with soil, because like we're using soil and leaves. I have a whole video on that, so let me just try to. Okay, then we have to light the fire, and then we give it, we cover it, we give it a few days, maybe 3 days, depending on how big the, how many trees you cut down. Then you give it a few days, maybe 3 days, 4 days, 1 week, and then when the fire, when the charcoal is ready, you harvest it, and then now you can use it to cook.
It's just fascinating. It's a whole process, but it's definitely better than just burning regular wood, right? I mean, it lasts longer, it burns better. Is it just explain the differences between once you have the charcoal versus just burning raw wood? How much more efficient it is?
The good thing with charcoal is that it does not produce smoke. It does not smoke completely. It's very clean, unlike firewood. So firewood is dirty, and you have to wait for it to dry up, which takes some time. And like charcoal, like you can burn a tree which is wet, and it's going to, like after it burns, after it becomes charcoal, it's clean. So that's the good thing with charcoal.
Let me ask you this, because there's a bunch of things we can talk about. I'm really impressed with your ability to speak English, and that's super hard to know multiple languages. And here in the U.S. where I'm at, very few people can speak multiple languages. Maybe in Europe it's more common that where they can speak more than one language. But how did you get to that point where you could speak English as well as you can? Because I'm really impressed by it. That's something that's hard, and many people here can't speak more than one language.
Oh, thank you. So have gone past have gone through our education system, the 844 system in Kenya. We usually learn everything in English apart from one subject called Swahili. Like that's our national language. So apart from that, the rest is everything else is learnt in English. And I've gone past high school to university. So I should be a bit fluent in communicating in English.
Yeah, it's good. No, I mean, that's awesome that you guys do that. Again, it's really impressive. I think that is. Yeah, go ahead.
But I speak other three languages. Yeah.
Awesome.
So I speak Swahili, Ekegusi, where I'm born, and then I speak Kikuyu.
That's great, man. What about moving to the agriculture side? Talk about just day-to-day, what you guys are doing on the farming side. How do you farm? What do you farm? And then how do you plan around having enough food? And are you just getting your food from the farming, or is that more a source of income for you and you sell it? Just talk to me about the agriculture side and what you're doing.
Okay, so where I'm from, we do different sorts of crop farming. We do tea farming, we do avocados, we do bananas, finger millet, maize, beans, maize, beans mostly, and tea, those three. Then we do agroforestry. We plant trees, mostly eucalyptus, blue gums, gravilla, yeah, and avocados. So, okay, it depends with the season. So we try to intercrop crops. Other times, like, we try to rotate crops. So this season we're planting, in some farms we have planted finger millet, in others we have planted maize and beans. So that's how, like, we rotate, we try to rotate and then intercrop, because we know how essential nitrogenous leguminous crops are to grasses like maize. So most of the work over here is done by hand, like it's manual. We don't have machines, including plucking tea, weeding, harvesting. Everything is done manually where I'm from. But we have another farm elsewhere in the Rift Valley whereby plowing is done by a tractor, but everything else from plowing now is done manually. So yeah. It's quite hectic. Like, it's hectic. I wish we had, for example, I did a video, I think the other day, on finger millet, weeding finger millet. Weeding finger millet is not an easy task. It's really strenuous. It requires very many people. Like, a hectare of land requires maybe 60 people to weed. 60 people, that's a lot of people. And if I decided to use, let's say, glyphosate, I'd use maybe, an example, 2,4-D, I'd use maybe 2 liters to clear the weeds. And that's going to be very convenient, cheap, actually very cheap compared to having very many people working for you. But the good thing is, where I'm from now, in my village, we have tiny lands. Like, we have a quarter of an acre, maybe an eighth, yeah, tiny land. So it's not a big problem.
So the land that you farm, is it more of a community land, or is it land that individuals own, or does everybody in the community farm and help each other out?
No, actually, our land, so our ancestors, they got this land. Like, they, back then, I think maybe, if I say, maybe 50 or 60 years ago, they found this land and then they said, okay, this land is mine, because, like, we didn't have very many people around. So they said, this land is mine, and that is it. So what we have done is, we have inherited whatever our ancestors had throughout decades. So I'm going to inherit my dad's land, but it, with time, like, our population has grown, and with time you realize that our the piece of the size of land that you own, that my dad owned, is going to be split maybe into 3 equal parts for my 2 brothers. And that means that that land is going to be tinier and tinier. So we have to find other ways. Maybe we buy land outside where we live. And that's the only way to solve that population and land problem.
Yeah, for sure. How do you, what about fertilizer? Do you guys have to fertilize? What about irrigation? How do you get water in? Talk about some of the logistics around making sure the crops succeed.
So where I'm from, irrigation is, like, we don't irrigate our crops completely, because, like, we have rain throughout the year apart from January and maybe a half of Feb, 2 weeks of Feb. But for the rest of the year, we have rain, like, throughout. For instance, it has been raining from the second week of Feb almost daily. I'd count the number of days it hasn't rained, maybe 5 days or 6 days. But every other day it's raining. Fertilizers, now that's where the big problem is, because we know for sure that the more you use fertilizer, the more fertilizer application, the more you're going to produce. So you find that most people over here use so little fertilizer. They buy fertilizer in kgs, so they buy 1 kg, 2 kgs, and they have to utilize it, minimize it. So, for instance, most people around here use, I think, around 20 kgs to 30 kgs of fertilizer per hectare. Actually, they use DAP. They don't top dress their crops. They don't apply CAN. So it's just DAP planting season. Others don't actually use that. They use manure because it's not because of organic, this organic movement that's going on. Actually, it's because they cannot access fertilizer, cheap fertilizer.
Right. So yeah. that makes it tougher on the yields, I guess. It's funny because you say the organic movement. It's like people want to, you know, make it to where everything's organic, but obviously you get a better yield probably if you're using more fertilizer. It just costs money. So it's like, I guess you guys could try to label it as organic, but I don't think anybody over there would care, right? Like they're just more worried about just getting the food, not whether it's got organic or not.
Yeah, actually, like us doing farming, we do farming so that we can earn our livelihood from it, so that we can feed our families and maybe surplus, like we sell the surplus and then schooling. Like if you have kids, you have to take them to school, you have to give them clothing, etc., etc. So it's not organic for us, like it's survival for us.
Yeah. So for the crops, when you sell them, that's the source of livelihood. Do you, is it just at local markets, or how do you sell the product? And then once you sell it, what are you using for a medium of exchange? I had another guest on from Kenya and they had the mobile payments. Is that what you guys use, or what do you use for money whenever you go to sell the product?
So it depends with the product, because for maize, an example, we sell maize to people nearby, because most people cannot produce enough and they have maybe their families working outside our village, maybe in Nairobi or outside the country. So they are sent money and they can afford to buy maize from us, beans from us, finger millet from us. That's how we usually sell. And it's usually, we have M-Pesa. It's a mobile banking system and it's so easy. Like it's very easy to use. And then we have local markets, like groceries. That's where we sell our vegetables. We have other markets whereby we sell our livestock. And then we have tea factories around here where we sell our tea leaves too. Yeah.
Yeah. It sounds like a pretty distributed system. You've got a bunch of different outlets for the product. It's not just like some market. You've got different ways you can monetize or sell the different products and maximize the value. It's not like you're just taking it to some marketplace. You actually have, you know, you're a supplier for various industries, right?
Yeah.
It's more comp. It's pretty interesting. It's really interesting. What do you think whenever you look at, I mean, I guess like to talk about Twitter for a second, you've got a really big following on Twitter and I see you're very active. You're using technology and social media. And when did you start getting into that? When did you start saying, hey, look, I'm going to reach people around the world and teach them about how I live?
Okay, so my account has been active from, I think, 2013 when I went to university, but I wasn't using my Twitter account as such. It was idle most of the time. So I started using my Twitter account to show people how we live, I think, from 2021 after the corona pandemic, 2021, 2020. So before that, I was using my Twitter account to advocate for environmental conservation, helping Greenpeace Kenya and Greenpeace Africa to advocate for whatever causes they were on. So, let me give out my brief like story how I got to where I am today. So back in university, I used to be an environmentalist. And I used to advocate for mostly like I hated plastics. I hated how we humans had polluted our environment. So I was helping other environmental organizations like Let's Do It Kenya and Greenpeace to organize events whereby we'd walk around the university, do some cleaning, collect some plastics, and then make sure they were placed like correctly. So back in 2020, during the corona period, we went to this event in Nakuru town, and we were doing some cleaning up, and I realized, like, it just dawned on me that in that town, because we went to two different places, one place was just clean, we were walking by, and another one near slums, it was very dirty. It had lots of plastics, mostly packaging for milk, essential foods, maybe oil, cooking oil and fats, stuff like that. And then cheap shoes, cheap sandals. So when I went home, I was thinking, like, it was something quite interesting for me, fascinating for me. And while you're thinking about it, like, I also wanted to be a very active Greenpeace member, a very active environmentalist. And so I got seriously, like, I was looking into what Greenpeace was doing. And then I came across a guy called Patrick Moore, a co-founder of Greenpeace. And then, like, it was a big realization to me. Like, I came to realize Patrick Moore was not a Greenpeace member anymore. So I was stunned. Like, how will somebody found such a big group and then, like, leave? I was so surprised. So I came to realize Patrick Moore left because Greenpeace was doing more harm, and it was doing stuff that he didn't agree with. Most, like, I think DDT and other stuff. So I go to Twitter, I followed Patrick Moore, and then somebody mentioned Patrick Moore had a book out, Fake Invisible Catastrophes and Threats of Doom. I go to read the book. It was really interesting. I learned so much from that book. And in one of Patrick Moore's Twitter tweets, somebody said, oh, you should check out Alex Epstein. And I did. And from that time, it has been like I've learned so much, I've studied so much, I've read so much. And I think that's why I am where I am today.
So that's really interesting. He's been a voice that has been somebody that came from being on the environmental side, and he switched over. And he's not the only person that has that story. I mean, there's another guy that I've had on named Brian Gitt. I don't know if you follow him on Twitter, but
I know him.
Yeah, he was big in the renewable space, and now he's more advocating for nuclear as well as fossil fuels. I know guys like Michael Schellenberger. If you've read his book, Apocalypse Never, he was very much, you know, a part of a lot of these causes, thought he was doing things for good, and then realized, you know, in a lot of ways they were making things worse. And it's not just an energy. It's also, like, even in the environmental conservationism stuff, a lot of times, you know, communities like the one you live in that have to live off the land, and they need, you know, the ability to harvest plants and animals. And then these environmentalist groups come in and they say, no, we got to turn this into a conservation, and it actually hurts those communities. Same thing as with the energy stuff. It seems like a lot of these policies for people that have an abundance of energy, it's not a big deal because they got too much of it. But for people that need it, it seems like it could be really harmful. Is that kind of what were the main points that he was making that you started to learn, to where the light came on for you and you started to realize, hey, wait a second, maybe this isn't the right way to think about things?
Okay. I was looking at humans. Okay. Mostly Alex Epstein. I was looking at humans as like a cancer. People, like, we were destroying our planet. We were hurting it. We were, I thought we were becoming, like, we were overpopulated. That's what I thought. And at some point, like, I felt at some point we wouldn't be able to sustain ourselves. But then I've come to realize, actually, back in 2020, I was doing a project. I planted beans, organic beans. I didn't want to hear anything about glyphosate and herbicides and pesticides. Like, I didn't want to use those stuffs. So I did. It was quite interesting because other people around me, they were using herbicides, pesticides, sorry, not herbicides. They were using pesticides. Actually, if you plant potatoes, Irish potatoes, and you don't spray them, we have a disease called blight. So blight comes and it wipes away your crop completely. There is no doubt about that. But for crops like potatoes, for crops like beans, they don't have a big problem. You can use other organic means, like I was doing. But then when you look at it, there are very many issues with what these I don't want to refer to them as alarmists, but they are. So what they propose, an example, organic farming. Organic farming is not sustainable. It cannot sustain our 8 billion people today. It cannot, because even like the data says today that over half of our population, they are fed by nitrogenous fertilizers. Nitrogenous fertilizers come from fossil fuels. So we have the four pillars of modern civilization. We have cement, we have steel, we have plastics. So if you look at, and then fertilizers. So if you look at these four, they depend on fossil fuels. Without fossil fuels, we don't have them. We don't have modern civilization. We don't have steel, we don't have buildings. We don't have cement, we don't have buildings. We don't have fertilizers, we don't have food. We don't have humanity. We don't have plastics. We don't have modern medicine. We don't have very many things. So we cannot do without fossil fuels, that's for sure. And what Africa needs is fossil fuels. So I was like, I liked how what the UN was up to, the Sustainable Development Goals. Because like those Sustainable Development Goals, they focus on our major problems. We have our major issues are poverty and we have hunger. Those two, like we're not fed and then we are very poor. So those two are our major problems. So I really loved, like, somebody got out there, they did a lot of research and they said, okay, we need to solve these two problems. But then now the problem came in when I read Patrick Moore and Sir Alex Epstein and the others, I came to realize that these sustainable development goals, they were tied to climate change. Like everything, if we're going to beat poverty in Africa, we need to do it sustainably, keeping, like conserving our environment. If we're going to do away with hunger, we're going to do that in keeping climate change in mind. So climate change, when they say climate change, they mean no fossil fuel use. Like we're not going to use fossil fuels. And that's a big problem. We cannot feed ourselves. We cannot become rich if we don't use fossil fuels. We cannot become rich if we don't mechanize our farming methods. We cannot become rich and fed if we do not use fertilizers, if we do not irrigate our farms. So it's a big realization anyway.
Do other people in your community or around you, do they see it the way you see it? Or is it a challenge to try to explain these ideas? I often wonder whether people, you know, in other countries are listening to this green narrative that you shouldn't use these things. Like you mentioned, you shouldn't use modern agriculture with fertilizer. You shouldn't use fossil fuel energy. And do people in communities like where you live, do they buy into that? Or is it something where they see it from your perspective? I just am wondering if you're somebody that's a rare person that thinks that way, or like, for example, when you guys go to university, are they teaching you something different and other people see it from the activist standpoint?
So most people in my community, they don't care about climate change. They actually don't. I don't think they know what climate change is. Like, they don't care. It's because they don't care, not because they are ignorant. So the thing is, okay, our education system has got the primary level, the secondary level, and then the university or college level. In the primary level, we learned so much about the environment conservation. We had Wangari Maathai. She won a Nobel Prize back in, I think, 2002 or something. So she's known throughout Kenya. Like, she did a lot. She was advocating for tree planting and I think wildlife conservation. So okay, our education system tells us that we need to conserve our environment, fight to be like Wangari Maathai, be known out there by everyone. and everything should be like green. We should plant trees everywhere. So that's what we are told. But most people don't care about climate change anyway, because they are very poor. They don't care about, like, they care. They are thinking what their next meal is going to be. So they don't have the time to think about other things. What somebody elsewhere, let's say in the US, is saying, or Kamala Harris is saying when she was in Uganda or Tanzania. So they don't care. In university, we have some units whereby you learn about the environment. They tell us that climate change is real. It's happening. They tell us that, okay, like I'm an agricultural engineer by profession. Back in university, we had like a whole, okay, my course is subdivided into about 6 parts. And renewable energy is one of them. So I've learned so much about tidal energy, solar, wind, all of those. I didn't learn about LNG, LPG, the extraction of fossil fuels, drilling. I didn't learn about that. But I know so much about clean energy. So that should say it all.
Yeah, so they're pushing a narrative. And I think that it is important to understand from people that follow you on Twitter, they don't know that you've had as much schooling as you've had, and that you are educated in terms of getting a higher degree and learning about this stuff. So it's not like you're somebody that's just reading stuff on the internet. I mean, you've learned through university. But it's interesting to me that they're not talking about extraction. I mean, it's the primary energy source on the planet, right? It's the thing that we use to power 80-81% or something like that of all of our energy comes from fossil fuels. And you're saying they didn't teach about that in your
they
classes?
They didn't. Yeah, they didn't. So it's just a little bit. Maybe they say petrol has got this energy density, diesel, stuff like that. But we're not told how petrol is gotten from oil, crude oil. They don't teach us that.
Yeah, that's kind of crazy to me. What does it seem like from your perspective, looking at these activists around the world? And I know you get into Twitter, you know, you get in their comments and you say things to them, which I think is admirable, because sometimes people need to, some of the stuff they're putting out is just so ridiculous. And I used to be more active on trying to argue with people. And then I kind of have this saying where I say, look, now I don't argue about religion anymore. And sometimes I feel like it's a religion for them. So it's like not worth it for me to argue. But I think that what you're doing is important. What does it seem like to you looking at these people, given the situation that you're in your culture?
So how, okay, sometimes, like yesterday when I did a tweet on how our parents, how my mom with our finger millet, somebody, so I said, okay, like we need access to glyphosate. Glyphosate will be like a very good alternative. And somebody said, okay, glyphosate is bad for you, it causes cancer, you guys, like, you need to find a way to use robotics and renewable energy and solar. So I actually, like, I told this person, did you go through my tweet? Like, did you watch that video? Because weeding is quite hectic. It's quite hectic. I have the video there. So some other times I think these people, they are religious. They think religiously. They don't think. They don't think with facts. They have not read. Actually, most people who argue with me about agriculture, they're not farmers. They don't know anything about farming. They've read a few books. They've read a few books on agriculture, so they think they know better. A few, maybe 2 weeks ago, I had this lady. Writes articles for IFAD or what is the other one? I think it's IFAD. So, or FAO. It could be FAO. Actually, I think it's FAO. So she was, okay, FAO posted that article report. It said, okay, Africa is moving this way in terms of agriculture. And this lady retweeted that, quoted that tweet and said, okay, I'm so happy because, like, I wrote this report. I was among those people who wrote this report. So I texted this chick. I asked her, are you a farmer by any chance? I'm just curious. And she told me, no, I'm not a farmer, but my family used to own a farm. So it says a lot about these people. Like most of these people, they are book smart. They know so much. They have read so much, but they have not been in the field. They don't know how things work around here. That's what made me try, like, welcome these people. I'm offering internships for these people. Like, if you feel you want to try living sustainably, you should come to Kenya. If you want to do organic farming, come to Kenya. I'm offering that at a cost, of course. Yeah.
Does it seem like people are pretty out of touch? I mean, you look at a lot of these posts, like, what's your thoughts about, like, watching the world and seeing just, like, the youth, especially young people, and just the way that they live in, like, the U.S. or in Europe? And then I look at what you guys are doing and, like, the work that you have to do, and it makes me feel very grateful, number one, that we have access to some of the things that we have, but it also makes me feel kind of ashamed that people don't even have the perspective of what you guys have to go through. Is it kind of weird watching people that are just totally clueless on, like, what it means to live and not have access to some of these luxury things that they have?
Okay, so these people, I'd say, okay, like, if you go back to 1800, where it's raining.
Yeah.
So no, if you go back to 1800, over 90% of the US population, they were farming, they were in agriculture, also in Japan, also in Europe. So what happened is modern agriculture saved these people. It saved your agriculture. It produced a lot of food, and you guys didn't have to work anymore, to work in your farms anymore. You can hear me?
Yeah, I can hear you.
Okay. So you guys didn't have to farm, and you went to other industries. So today, only 2% of the US population feeds the rest of the population. In Europe, about 5%. In Japan, about the same number. So these people, like, they don't know what it is like to live here. They have lots of energy, easily accessible. They have cars. Like, you are living the best lives.
It's just interesting to me because I feel like after watching your videos that it just is a big eye opener, and that it really gives me some perspective on the challenges of not having the stuff that we take for granted, I think. What about, you made a tweet the other day talking about China and the United States and some of the investments that China was making in Africa. And you made a comment like, well, you know, China is better for us than the United States. Can you talk about that a little bit? Just your thoughts there.
Okay. The reason why I say China is better than the US for us is because if you look at it today, what the US is advocating in Africa is sustainable development goals, everything tied to climate change. And an example, China. China is working, they have this roads and bridges initiative. They are doing a lot of good work. They're building bridges, they're building roads, they're building railways, they're building airports, power plants. They're doing a lot of good, like, okay, and then their loans are very cheap compared to the US, the IMF or World Bank loan. So you cannot compare the two. Maybe I think about 2.5% interest compared to IMF 5%, almost 5%. And then, so the IMF tells Africans, for example, last year they were telling our government, okay, you need to sell fossil fuel, like you need to sell petrol and diesel at a higher price. You need to stop subsidizing that given amount. You need to subsidize, like, okay. So anyway, what happened is the government said, no, we're not going to listen to you guys because how we're going to develop our community, our economy, is by using lots of fossil fuels, by using petrol. If we're going to make petrol very expensive for most people to afford them, we're going to have poor transport. Most people are not going to travel. They're not going to jobs. They're not going to everything coming from, an example, fertilizer coming from the port all the way to where we live, about 1,000 kilometers away, it's going to be very expensive. So once petrol prices go up, everything else goes up. Almost everything else goes up anyway, unless you're getting it from the farm. Actually, even getting it from the farm means, like, if I'm going to use fertilizer, fertilizer is going to be expensive. So once I harvest my crops, I'm going to sell my produce at a higher price. So that's what the IMF does. Most of the time it tells the government, you need to pay your loans, and one of the best ways for you to pay your loan is to tax more, especially reduce your subsidies when it comes to fertilizers and petrol. And that's not a good thing. So China, they don't do that. An example, they build as the SGR. SGR is a very great infrastructure, a very good investment for Kenya as a country. It's going to help us in so many ways. That's what the Chinese are doing. They want us to develop so that they can sell us their goods. The US is doing the opposite. They do not want us to develop. That's the difference between those two. And also Russia. Russia is giving us fertilizers at a very cheap price. Some other times they say, okay, like I think 2 weeks ago they gave us fertilizer, 32,000 tons of nitrogenous fertilizer. That's a good thing for us. So Russia is looking at the problem at the core, the root. The US is saying, okay, we're going to give you food. We're going to give you aid, food aid. And they do that. Okay, I'm not saying giving us food aid is bad, but Russia is doing the opposite. They're giving us, they're teaching a man to fish.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's exactly what I was thinking of. It's like teach a man to fish and he can be fed forever, give a man a fish and he's fed for the day. It's just interesting because, you know, intuitively it feels like these climate and energy policies disadvantage, you know, poorer people, not just over there, but even in the US. It's like you look at California, which has a ton of wealth. It's a very rich state. But there's a lot of people there, and there's a lot of poverty there as well. It's got some of the biggest homeless problems. And rather than tackling the homeless problem or, you know, the high cost of living there, they're doing things like mandating electric vehicles or, you know, trying to get rid of their nuclear power whenever their grid has all these problems. And so it's like I see it in the U.S. where we have these politicians that are pushing for these policies that I think you can demonstrate that it's hurting poorer people here in the US, but it's really interesting to get your perspective from the worldwide view that countries in the Western world that are pushing these policies versus countries like China and Russia that are really pushing more of the basic needs. Like Russia produces a lot of energy. They produce a lot of food. China is basically going to do whatever they need to do to help lift their people out of poverty. They're burning a lot of coal. And I think that it's, to me, that's a really interesting perspective. It's because I think here we view China and Russia as the bad guys, but from your perspective, maybe the stuff that they're saying is actually helpful for you versus the stuff that the US and Europe is saying is actually could be hurtful. It's a very interesting perspective to me.
Yeah, actually that's just it. And even for the EVs, the EV mandate, I don't think it's going to help you in any way. Actually, it's going to make your life terrible, if you allow me to use that. So, I was reading this report the other day, and only 15% of US drivers can afford an EV, which goes for about an average of $60,000. I'm not going to refer to that like to Africans, because we cannot, we can right now, if you came to my village, maybe about 1%, actually less than 1% own cars, less than 1%. So yeah, it's not our problem, but it's going to hurt you really bad, especially the US and Europe. For China, I don't think the Chinese really are, they are not, they are going to have problems because they ban coal. Coal is very cheap. They produce most of the EVs in China, like most of the EVs are produced in China, I think about actually more than 55%. So that's a good thing. And the sales also, most of the EVs also are happening in China. China's got cheap electricity, cheap energy. They produce the EVs cheaply compared to the US. So the US is going to suffer and Europe is going to suffer.
Yeah. Tend to agree. What about solar? I see, I've seen you argue a little bit with people about solar. You know, intuitively to somebody that may not know the struggles that you face and what your needs are, maybe someone might think solar is a good idea because it's like you put it in and then it creates power. But as you mentioned, it rains a lot there. Does anybody in your area use solar power? Is that something that's common? Have you looked at using solar power? Just your thoughts on solar.
Yeah, we've had a solar panel, I think, for over 10 years. We don't use it anymore because we have electricity. Electricity is reliable, like the grid is quite reliable, although it's not as reliable as in the US. So my thoughts on solar... solar. Okay, in Germany, an example, solar works for, I think, for about 12% of the, it works for 12% of the total time. Like if you have 24 hours, so 12% of 24, that's when we have the sun. So that's when the solar is producing electricity. In places like my home, I think it's about 25%. So it's working 25% of the time. If somebody told you you need solar, even if solar was 100% efficient, the sun is going to light for about 30% or 25% of the time. And that means you need another reliable energy source, electricity source. For us, luckily in Kenya, we have a lot of geo, we have a lot of hydro, and the two are going to work miracles for us because like we have a big potential. We have about 20 gigawatts for each, I think, something of the sort. So like we right now we are at 3 gigawatts. Like we have a lot of it and it's quite cheap. But the problem is now the government of Kenya is being pushed by countries like Germany, mostly Europe and the US. And they are setting up wind farms. Like we have the biggest wind farm in Africa, and our government brags about that. But if you look at it from the past, like for the past 1 year, we've had our electricity prices have been increasing. I think they have almost doubled So we're getting electricity at 20 cents per kilowatt hour. I think that's the almost, actually it's more expensive than you guys, what you guys pay for electricity in the US. And that's not a good thing because we are very poor, although we use so little electricity. So when people say solar and wind, no, it's not going to work. Even wind turbines work about 30% of the time because wind doesn't blow every time. And that's a big problem. A good example is Germany. Germany, they have used more than 500 billion euros. And if you look at their, like they're burning a lot of coal today. They're burning a lot of coal. They have no alternative. They shut down their last nuclear power plant. They're going to suffer anyway. So solar and wind, no.
Yeah. Yeah, it's the same, a lot of the same views here. It's making our grid a lot weaker in the U.S. We've got a lot of problems. I mean, Oklahoma, where I live, is just north of Texas. So we're pretty close to Texas. Like where I live is about 3-hour drive from Texas. It's not far. And we do have a lot of wind in Oklahoma. But the main reason we can have wind power is because we've got a ton of reliable energy. We've got a lot of natural gas. We've got access to coal. and a little bit of solar. There's not much solar, but we've got a ton of gas and a ton of coal. And so, and it's super windy here. Like Oklahoma is one of the, I don't know if you've ever heard the song Oklahoma. It's like a famous old song, but it's like the wind comes sweeping down the plains. And it's no joke. Like that's the lyric in the song. We get a ton of wind. I mean, it is like, there's more days when it's windy here than when it's not. So certain places it can make sense. And I think at times it'll power 30 to 40% of our grid, but then there's other times where it doesn't power hardly any. And it kind of makes sense for us here because we just, it's the one of the windiest places in the U.S. So we get a ton of wind, but the only reason it can work is because we have these reliable energy sources that are there whenever we need them and they're cheap. So it's not a solution that can work for everybody. Sometimes when I talk bad about wind, people will bring up the point, well, your state uses a ton of wind energy. And I'm like, yeah, well, we do is because we have a lot of wind. So it's like, you know, it's not one size fits all. Yeah. So anyways, it's just interesting to hear that perspective. I think it echoes a lot of what the way I view it as well. Last thing to talk about here, the way that you're utilizing technology to reach people, we touched on it earlier, but aren't you also doing a newsletter? Do you have a Patreon? Are you trying to do anything to generate income from the content side? Because I think what you're doing is fascinating, and I'm sure people would want to subscribe and pay if they could. Given, you know, the quality of content that you're putting out, are you trying to do any of that in terms of monetizing what your content can do?
First, thank you very much. I had one point before I can talk on about
sure.
that.
Yeah, yeah, go ahead. Go for
yeah, and another thing I left out is when you have, like, you need to have a reliable system before, then you can add on solar and wind. So that's right. Two systems. And that means it's going to be expensive to run the two systems, to build the two systems. It's going to be expensive. So okay, thank you very much about that because I try as much as I can. Like whenever I'm free, like for the past, we were supposed to have our talk last week, and then I've been busy. At the same time, it rains a lot. Like every day it's raining. I think. It only yesterday didn't rain for the past 1 week. So anyway, I try to document, like mostly I'm doing farming. Every other day I'm doing farming or I'm doing other farming related activities, maybe cutting trees down. I sell firewood to a nearby factories actually. So I try to capture those moments. I try to capture different scenes. Like today I captured, I was top dressing our finger millet. That's what I was doing today. Yesterday I was doing other things. Like every day I try to document all of that and then maybe I'll upload to my Twitter mostly. But I thought of Patreon because somebody told me okay, we need to see most of this, so editing a whole video and thinking about like putting that all of that much work into the editing and filming and everything, it's not easy. I think I thought I should maybe try to generate some money from all of that, so I signed up on Patreon. I have like a page, but somebody else told me, okay, you need to do Substack because Patreon is, so now I have second thoughts, but for the next coming days, I'm going to post mostly on my Patreon until I can work out around Substack because Substack says like, if you're not from the US, Australia, Europe, if there is no way you're going to connect your page and your bank. So yeah.
Gotcha.
But well, I have a like, Patreon. Yeah, I have a Patreon.
It seems like an opportunity. I mean, I don't know how many people use social media or use the internet to make money, but it seems like it's an opportunity for people because you're so connected with the world. And I'm glad that we had to have this conversation. I mean, this is what gets me excited is to talk to people that I would never have a chance to talk with. And I'm really glad you came on. I mean, I love hearing your perspective. I think, you know, getting perspectives like these is really helpful for me and hopefully for the listeners. What's the best place for people to find you on? Is it Twitter, or what's the best place people can follow you?
So on Twitter, Jusper Machogu, that's where you'll find me.
Awesome. Jusper, thank you for coming on, man. I appreciate you doing the episode and trying to avoid the rain.
Thank you very much, Mark. Pleasure talking to you.
Thanks, guys.